Would you please stand? Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you our hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Trust in you with all our hearts, for as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please do be seated. A very good evening to you all and welcome to Calvary. It's good to be together, whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us online. It's wonderful to be worshiping the Lord on this great day. A special welcome to you if you're new here. Maybe you're visiting Perhaps you're new to Golden. Maybe this is your first time at Calvary. We do have these welcome cards that I hope you see in the backs of the pews. If you've not previously completed one of these, I'd encourage you to do so. If you give us a name, phone number, email, we'll be in touch to answer any questions you might have. Right after the service, there's an opportunity to visit for a while next door here in the parish hall. So look forward to seeing you there. Just a couple of things to mention. Our Sunday morning worship schedule is changing as of tomorrow. Now, I realize many of you, this might be your service of choice, so 5 p.m. Saturday is not changing at all. But just in case you do occasionally come on Sunday morning, be aware that from here on out, the schedule is this. 7:15 here in the chapel for a said service, no music. Then 8:30 here in the chapel with music. 9:30 in the Great Hall with music. And 11:15 here in the chapel, again with music. So the reason for that change is we are growing. We're seeing more and more people coming, especially here in the chapel. We had a 10:30 service that was getting to the point of almost being maxed out. And so that's the reason for the change in schedule. It does mean for us clergy, especially whoever's preaching that weekend, we're basically running from one service to the next. So please don't take it personally if I or whoever's preaching ducks out on you and doesn't have a whole lot of a chance to visit. We are trying to address that by making sure that our pastoral staff and lay leaders who aren't scheduled to preach are available and present to you. So yeah, that's our service schedule change. If you are a regular at Calvary and you get our weekly emails, you'll have seen the email that came on Wednesday. We have all kinds of opportunities right now at Calvary for you to serve in different ways. You know, this is part of rebuilding, which most churches are going through, kind of putting their programs back together. And we have all kinds of opportunities in different areas of church life. So please do take seriously that call to serve in different ways. If you don't get our regular email and would like to, talk to me after the service and I can get you signed up for that. Now, we would love to pray for anybody who has a birthday this week. Anyone present who has a birthday? No? Okay, I've got a list here of folks that I know of. Tomorrow, Hattie Hoover turns 3 years old. And Harrison White turns 4 years old. It's also Blake Langos' birthday on Monday. On Wednesday, Bruce McDonald and Brigham Palmer. Friday, Linda Knudsen. And Ellie Reichen turns 2 on Friday. On Saturday, Joy Mosley and Catherine Wolfe and Delaney Sheridan will be 9 years old next Saturday. So let's pray for these folks with the birthday prayer in your bulletin. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall, and in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. What about wedding anniversaries? Any couples here present celebrating a wedding anniversary? Would the two of you like to stand? John and Pam, when is your wedding anniversary?
Wednesday.
It's coming Wednesday, and how many years will you be celebrating? Is that right? You got to check with the boss, John, before you say it with such confidence.
He just checked.
He just did. 53 years. That's wonderful. Congratulations. There are a few others that I'm aware of. On Monday, Lance and Catherine Gardner are celebrating 13 years. On Tuesday, Peter and Bethany Bryce, 7 years. And on Saturday, Marilyn and Andrew Tomlin, 34 years. So let's pray for John and Pam and these others. O gracious and ever-living God, you have created us, male and female, in your image. Look mercifully upon this man and this woman who come to you seeking your blessing, and assist them with your grace, that with true fidelity and steadfast love, they may honor and keep the promises and vows they have made, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Congratulations. Thank you. Just one last announcement. We have the distinct pleasure of having Millie Thomas play organ for us tonight. We're very thankful for you, Millie. Millie is standing in for Dennis Van Patter, who is standing in for Dean Stalnacker. You know that Dean is undergoing continuing cancer treatment. Dennis, on the early hours of Wednesday morning, suffered a mild heart attack. They were able to treat it. He's having a follow-up treatment on Tuesday. And I don't really like to nag people, but I had to tell him to go home when I found him in the office this afternoon. So he is making it seems like he's making a very quick and a very full recovery, but please do be praying for Dennis that that is the case, and that he does figure out how to take it easy, at least for the next week or so. But again, thank you, Millie, for standing. Our worship continues. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as it seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, declares the Lord. Like clay in the hand of the potter, so you are in my hand, O house of Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or a kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, and if that nation I warned repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I had planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended for it. Now therefore say to the people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says. Look, I am preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join together in reading today's psalm. Lord, you have searched me out and known me.
You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places, and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it together. You press on me, behind me, before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. For you yourself created me in my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body is not hidden from you, while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. They were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them. How deep I find your thoughts, O God, how great is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my life's prepared, need to be like yours.
A reading from Paul's letter to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith, so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I appeal to you on the basis of love. I then, as Paul, an old man now and also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and me. I am sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would like to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do will be spontaneous and not forced. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back for good, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I ask. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able, with 10,000 men, to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off, and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please do be seated. It's a feature of the Gospels, as we read them, that as well as the disciples, who clearly are spending a lot of time with Jesus, there's also a great crowd that is following him around from one place to another. Luke makes that clear here in the passage that Bethany has just read to us. A large crowd are traveling with him, but they are separate. They're somehow distinct from the disciples. There's a difference in the kind of commitment that these 12 men have made to Jesus. What is the nature of discipleship that makes it stand out from the crowd? What is the shape of discipleship? Well, I believe this short passage from Luke chapter 14 has much to say on that topic. I want to draw out 3 points, and to do so, we need to unpack some misunderstandings about this passage first. The first misunderstanding could be described as the demands of discipleship. The demands of discipleship. Jesus says here, if anyone does not hate his family, he cannot be my disciple. That's a strong word, isn't it? Hate. It seems so extreme. It conjures up in our mind that discipleship is a kind of Navy SEAL commitment, that Jesus is looking for a few good men. But that's the first misunderstanding. We have to remember that for many rabbis, not just Jesus, in this first century Jewish context, a lot of their teaching used a tool. It's called hyperbole. And hyperbole is overstating the case in perhaps a shocking way in order to make the point, in order to get people's attention, and in order to make a point. Elsewhere in the Gospels, we hear Jesus say, "If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away." It's hyperbole. He doesn't actually want people to self-harm. It's a teaching tool. If we read the parallel passage to Luke chapter 14 in Matthew, it's Matthew chapter 10, Jesus' words are conveyed in this way. If anyone loves his family more than me, they cannot be my disciple. In Jewish first century culture, family was everything. It conferred status and security, even salvation. Remember that Jews would say that we're children of Abraham, as if that was enough to secure their salvation. Jesus is saying that he must be our first love. We owe him our first and highest allegiance, even above our families. And without the agape love of Jesus, our love for our family and friends is less than ideal. In fact, it's inadequate. So the daunting demands of discipleship become a right prioritizing of our relationship with Jesus above all other relationships. That's the first point about discipleship. Jesus is our priority. The second misunderstanding from this passage could be described as the decision for discipleship. The decision for discipleship. It goes something like this. Do you have the requisite resources to be a true follower of Jesus? Jesus tells two really short little parables. One about a man who's trying to build a tower, and the second about a king who's preparing to go to war. And the misunderstanding of these two parables suggests that we need to take a realistic inventory of our resources. Is it achievable for us to follow Jesus? You see, the original hearers of Jesus and these two stories, they would have something very different in mind. If they heard a story about building a tower that wouldn't reach its full height, they would immediately think of the Tower of Babel. Discipleship is not about building ourselves up. Again, Jesus' first hearers, when they hear a story about a king about to go to war against a mighty enemy, they would think about the multiple failures of the kings of Judah and Israel against mighty empires, the Babylonian Empire, the Syrian Empire. After all, Jesus and these people around him are living under military rule, a vassal state to the Roman Empire. Discipleship is not about fighting the Lord's battles for him from our own strength, which actually is no strength at all. The Christian writer Andy Crouch makes it really clear that these two stories are actually about the cost of choosing not to follow Jesus. If we choose not to be a disciple of Jesus, then we are trying to manage our life with our own meager, limited resources, and they will never be enough. Jesus is not looking for those who think they have anything to offer, but for those who know they don't. Or as Scott put it recently, God does not call the equipped, he equips the called. So this decision for discipleship is actually about a humble realization that choosing not to follow Jesus is the really foolish decision. The third misunderstanding could be described as the distinctiveness of disciples. Jesus says, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? We all know that salt is perhaps the most distinctive taste that there is. Followers of Jesus are supposed to be distinctive. But if we haven't corrected that second misunderstanding, we will try to be distinctive in some combination of building a tower for God to impress other people, or declaring war on the so-called godless culture around us. Surely there are enough disgraced Christian empires that have set themselves up as shining examples of faithful discipleship. The only distinctive they display is an arrogant self-righteousness. Or lobbing gospel hand grenades at people whose values don't line up with ours will only leave blood on the carpet. The only distinctives of the Christian culture warrior are anger and judgmentalism. No, not only is salt a distinctive taste, it's also a tasty taste. It makes all other foods that it comes into contact with even more tasty. What should followers of Jesus taste like? They should taste like Jesus. And he tasted good. Jesus didn't have to build an empire nor fight any wars, and yet he had no problem gaining followers and starting a revolutionary missionary movement that would change the world. Finally, I asked the question at the very start, what is the shape of discipleship? In verse 27, Jesus says, anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Discipleship is cross-shaped. Discipleship is cruciform. To follow Jesus is to die to ourselves. But as we die to self, Jesus rises within us. As we die to self, his kingdom takes root around us. As we die to self, the distinctive sweet taste of Christ Jesus transforms our lives, a sweetness that we can offer the world that he loves and came to save. Take up your cross and follow King Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please stand as we affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Amen.
Ask your prayers for people, for God's people throughout the world. For our Bishop Kim and for this gathering, for the priesthood of all believers, pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of him. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
Lord, hear the prayers of your people, and what we have asked faithfully, grant that we may obtain effectually, to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Would you please stand? The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please do share a sign of God's peace with those around you. Peace be with you. Millie, peace be with you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Saviour and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, our Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Would you please stand? Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ's coming. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. No, we were supposed to be at the top of the list when they were starting to sell tickets. And I went on the website and they
I don't want you to hear the church speaker. See the church mice?
And they have a balcony too.
And then there's a Latin inscription under it. It says, "Blessed be the cheesemakers." And John did that. We never used to have this in here.
Now who's John?
He was a pastor was here for 28 years and he did all this building.
Well, who was the lady pastor here?
And I want to
a long time ago, 20 years ago or so, there was a lady pastor that performed the wedding. That
we except there's no
home. Oh, it may have been Kathy Hitch. Kathy Lawton. One of the two.
She might have been a visitor.
Right.
She's retired. I think she maybe got burned out a little bit, and she has two little kids now.
We're only here that one time.
Yeah.
We didn't have the reception.
Did she do the homily or something? And was it great?
She married them.
No, not like that. This is good.
Well, she preaches just
she married.
She married.
He was one of our employees.
She's a wonderful woman. They're all pretty good.
Yeah. So I thought, not like him. Have you ever had that sermon? And those scriptures?
I don't remember.
Shall I write them down for you?
You didn't know about.
I got confused.
Him, he used to sing all the time.
Yeah, it's a cultural altar. I can't think of it now.
I need to excuse myself for one minute. I'm singing here. You're leaving. I'm saying our prayer.
And
they think they might have to do another one, but they can do it in their doctor's office.
Really?
That's what they said. I said, really? So,
this woman,
this girl gets courage to get out. And he of course, he got up with that dress.
I don't know.
In the middle of the night, he drove himself to his house. And he drove himself home yesterday because he wouldn't stop.
Can't take communion anymore.
Oh, I know that. But Tim said he's not interested. I'm sure he'll be able to
be right.
I told Tim I'm available next week.
I don't know if they do. I don't know if they do.
Well, that's so. And it's Dean.
I haven't heard about Dean lately.
He's not sure. He hasn't heard anything either.
Pat and Rod.
Look.
Keith Nelson. Killian Keaton was first touched in the heart. I think they would probably know it, but I don't know it, I guess. I haven't heard.
And Jim says you guys have more than enough for Christmas.
Yeah, I think so. Well, I gave the deposit, so it's so
good.
I think we will hardly rock it out. 30 years, 40 years, 70 years.
And I don't have to give up my money until 10 days before.
Yeah.
And I don't have to pay the rest of the money until then, so that's great.
Well,
I'm thinking if I get 10 tickets,
yeah,
that's fine. Anybody else, get your own.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we'll see you there.
I couldn't figure out how to send the little brochure thing.
Yeah.
I'm not very good on the computer,
Well, you're. I think, don't think all the
and my eyes are good. I'm sure that was. It was a public IG.
One of the things that we used to teach in marketing, and this, I'm serious, is you make a minor mistake in an email, and then you can send out the corrections. So you get two readers.
Well, that's two for the price of one.
I do that most all the time.
Take care, Millie.
Okay. Have fun on your cruise.
Oh, we will.
I'm sorry. Hello.
How
was the train ride coming, Wally?
You did amazing.
Amazing.
Oh, my God. It's song that is an Irish song that you played.
During the prelude?
Yes.
Simple Gifts.
Well, you did pretty good. They may keep you.
If I read the whole thing about water and realized it was singing $3 prayer, I might have had the music in front.
Is that what you were looking for?
Yes. Yes. So I'm sitting there all during the sermon, doing it in my head, and doing it on the keyboard, and I think, oh God, I was
so bad. You were here with us.
It plays it.
George Beverly Shea sang it.
He played it ever since he started the ministry.
Yeah.
He used that
call to the altar. Yep.
I cannot think of the name of it.
Well,
that's when everybody came.
What was it? Just As I Am.
Just As I Am.
Just As I Am. With all the
fleas.
That's it.
You sure about that?
I am positive about that.
Well, I don't remember how it goes. It's a theme.
Can you play it?
Yes.
Please. I can't carry a tune.
I don't know it. I love him, but I don't
know. We went to see him twice.
Oh, really? Oh.
Right.
We were amazed by him.
It was unbelievable
to
go to one of those things. Actually, we went to the old My Hall Stadium. The place,
oh, really?
The place was packed. I don't know. I think we went. I thought we went twice. We may have only gone once. You want a little quick tour of the rest? Or are you going home or you want to?
We're headed home or whatever we're doing. I guess we're headed home. Yeah, it's just beautiful. I love this.
I knew you would. Paintings. Look at the ceiling.
Yeah, I know. I was impressed.
You want to? If I take them on a little tour, do you want to go?
I'll catch up.
Okay.
She knows the layout.
She knows it like the back. Oh, she lives down here. She's almost here as much as Bethany is.
Oh, my goodness.
Went out and bought more gas cards today.
Did you really?
Yes, I did. The grant money came
through.
Oh,
we said the other day we were out, we really were all the way.
Like all the way. So what I did was the grant money came in Thursday. I got it deposited in to the rescue fund account, but I wanted Scott through our church system to order a bunch, $125 cards. And that takes a week or a week and a half to get them. So I went down to King Supers and just bought 10 for now to kind of carry us on until those arrive.
Yeah, yeah.
But that, you know, my buying the cards, that comes out of the grant money.
Yeah.
$8,000.
Oh, right. Good. Is it all for the food bank and everything? And the cards?
It's just for grocery cards and gas. That's it. $8,000.
Great.
I asked for six, they gave us eight.
Great. So is that for you?
Well, I can't ask. I don't know if I can ask again. You know, they don't like to sustain. They don't want to get in a position of come to us every year.
Yeah. And we'll who gave it to you?
City of Golden.
The city? Okay. When I was working at Denham, it was the same thing, like with the the Daniels Fund and all those big ones that give money to nonprofits.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That was awesome. You really
How'd you like Sweet Hour of Prayer?
I thought it's fantastic.
Oh my God. I didn't even see, there wasn't any number, so I didn't have any.
So how'd you figure it out?
So
you just did it?
All the time he was preaching, I was over there on the keyboard.
Good for you!
And I don't do that. I mean, I don't play by ear.
Yeah.
Ever. Ever.
Well, you did great. I could not believe it when I saw that.